Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank Jenny and Екатерина for the kind invitation.
Друзья, за приглашение. Прежде всего, я хотел выразить свою славу благодарность уважаемой Екатерине Ивановой и Леониду Дмитриевичу Федорову. Сегодня мы поговорим про малоинвазивные эндоскопические методы диагностики пациентов с воспалительными заболеваниями
в кишечнике.
Я покажу вам, как вы можете видеть исследование слизистой оболочки тонкой кишки при этом. И мы знаем, что капсульная эндоскопия, она очень позитивно влияет на визуализацию слизистой оболочки тонкой кишки. И в ряде случаев даже она может существенно дополнительно
включать колоноскопию.
И я хотел сделать небольшой ревью для того, чтобы определить, что будет происходить в ближайшем будущем с капсульной эндоскопией. Преимущество эндоскопических методов исследования, в частности капсулы, перед лицом других методов, таких как рентгеноскопия, и поэтому у пациентов с подозрением на болезнь Крона эффективность эндокапсулы достаточно высокая, и она может коррелировать с высокотехнологичными магнитно-резонансными исследованиями.
A reference, an established gold standard. So we don't know if capsule endoscopy might be considered the study test or it's our reference standard. And the other big problem ahead, looking at this trial and this meta-analysis, is that how we define using capsule endoscopy
the diagnostic of Crohn's disease? Толстой кишки. Проблема, которая есть с капсульной эндоскопией, это то, что большинство данных, которые мы получаем при помощи капсульной эндоскопии, это, как правило, ложные положительные результаты. Поэтому основная проблема с капсульной эндоскопией – это проблема верификации ложных положительных результатов. Существует большое количество научных исследований, посвященных специфичности капсулы. Это очень юнкие, красивые исследования, но их результаты очень интересны. Если вы посмотрите, то специфичность эндокапсулы недостаточно высока. И это значит, что у нас большое количество, как еще раз напомню, ложных положительных результатов. Итого, с чувствительностью, как вы видите, все хорошо, чувствительность очень высокая в сравнении с традиционными эндоскопическими исследованиями, именно специфичность страдает.
With a suspected Crohn's disease. In fact, we mentioned that 80%
когда мы заподозреваем болезнь, то это 80%.
And so we can explore this portion of the small bowel using the iron colonoscopy. And in fact,
if you do, конечно, нам нужно вписывать хронометраж исследований в стандарты и включать капсулу в эту структуру. Там уже четко выработанный алгоритм диагностики и лечения пациентов. Мы должны понимать, что сначала мы должны поднять телеколоноскопию, затем нам нужно делать мультислезовую диагностический метод. И если у нас диагностическая эффективность этих методов нас не устраивает, то необходимо переключаться на капсульную эндоскопическую процедуру. Фактически в 2015 году Европейское общество по интестинальной эндоскопии попыталось прописать перспективы капсульной эндоскопии после эндоскопии при сложной диагностике воспалительных заболеваний толстой кишки.
So it's not anymore iron colonoscopy first and then cross section and then capsule endoscopy, but capsule endoscopy, we might use capsule endoscopy immediately after iron colonoscopy.
Поэтому теперь у нас нет такого обязательного этапа, как завершение именно колоноскопии и мультислезового исследования перед капсулой. На самом деле теперь капсульной эндоскопии можно дополнять традиционную колоноскопию с позиции Европейского общества по интестинальной эндоскопии. И это эти гайдлайны
15-й включает в новые концепции Well, it's only 31%, and I think that is unacceptable, this positive predictive value. So, when we look at these numbers, these accuracy parameters, we need to admit that we cannot play very much with sensitivity and specificity, but we can play a little bit more with the positive and negative, with the predictive values in
general.
And we can play with predictive values in reaching the capsule endoscopy population of Crohn's disease. So the idea that is behind is that if we proper select my patients, I might increase, I might enrich my population, and probably I can improve my positive prediction. And how we can enrich our capsule endoscopy population of Crohn's disease patients? Well, this was a working group that they offered some ideas how we should select our patients, how we should define a suspected disease. And they suggest to include symptoms, so the clinical symptoms, of patients with eventual extra-intestinal symptoms, but then we should have positive lab markers and possibly positive radiology. Well, if we use this way to consider, to select our population, well, you see that the positive predictive value goes from 31% to 50%. That is not ideal, but it's better than 31%. Without affecting at the moment the negative predictive value. So the key point, how we can maximize the role or the accuracy of gastroendoscopy in patients with suspected Crohn's disease is mainly to properly select and to have a clear definition of what we define for suspected Crohn's disease. The other option that is quite widely available today is to use some lab biomarkers like calprotectin or the lactoferrin. We know that they are increased in patients with inflammatory bowel disease. But if we use these parameters, then we might accurate select those patients who may benefit from capsule endoscopy, and they work quite well with good sensitivity and specificity for both the lactoferrin and the calprotectin. And in fact, if we combine the end, the clinical symptoms, the age, usually younger patients have a higher probability in a setting of clinical suspicion, and the lab in terms of calprotectin or lactoferrin, calprotectin is much more available, then you see that we move from that 30% to 71% the positive predictive value. On the other side, if we still use the calprotectin to select our patient and to define the suspected Crohn's disease patient, well, it works quite well. In this meta-analysis, the group of Rani and Liakin, they went to analyze different cutoffs, going from 50 to 100 to 200. It's clear that at the moment we use 50%, we have an excellent sensitivity, but our specificity is very low. If we increase up to 200 sensitivity vice versa, we have a suboptimal sensitivity and we have an excellent specificity. Well, what I want to analyze is the role of different cutoff using to predict and the use of capsule endoscopy and the accuracy of capsule endoscopy in defining Crohn's disease. What is interesting and is that if we use in the setting of the suspected Crohn's disease, if we use the cutoff of 50 micrograms per gram, then we have an excellent sensitivity. So what does it mean? Look at the negative predictive values, 92%. So what does it mean? That if we have a patient with a clinical suspicion of Crohn's disease, but the calprotectin is below 50%, actually the likelihood of a positive diagnosis of capsule endoscopy is extremely low. So a simple test like calprotectin we must use to predict and to understand if this patient might benefit from capsule endoscopy or not. If you don't have calprotectin, if it is not available, well, we might use different biomarkers like leukocyte, iron level, and C-reactive protein. And in this interesting paper was published this year from a group from Portugal, where they went to analyze the different using the univariate and multivariate and then logistic regression, and then they defined that high level of C-reactive protein and low level of serum iron are important variables to select our patient, and when they are abnormal, we have a consistent correlation with Crohn's disease. We get not excellent, but reasonable in general. So, what's the role
назначать эндоскопические диагностические вмешательства, постепенно вероятность появления интервенции
болевания.
Итак, роль капсулы в этом, если мы подозреваем болезнь,
of suspected Crohn's disease is the negative pressure. So what I used is the possibility I have used the capsule to exclude the Crohn's disease because the negative predictive value is almost 100%. But what's the role of capsular endoscopy in patients with an established Crohn's disease? Actually, again, in this sense, there is capsular endoscopy does not add very much to the traditional radiology and cross-sectional imaging tests and endoscopy. So, capsular endoscopy is comparable to traditional radiology, cross-sectional imaging tests, and to
endoscopy.
So, why we should use capsular endoscopy? What might be the role of capsular endoscopy in a patient where I know that he's still suffering from Crohn's disease? But we have a subgroup of patients with high unexplained symptoms, and it might be useful in this setting to use the capsular endoscopy, but I think the most interesting point is the staging and the monitoring of the response to the infection. And this is why also the ECHO guidelines support the role of capsular endoscopy in initial small bowel assessment, that means in staging of patients with Crohn's disease, to monitor the response of the treatment, or in case we have an asymptomatic patient but we have abnormal events, or again to follow up these patients in case of relapse or in symptomatic patients with the other tests who are negative, or to detect the postoperative. But what I most like, and this is very important, very actual, is the monitoring of these patients, patients with chronic disease, and to monitor the response of this patient to treat. And the mucosa indicates it's now a considered part of the response of the treatment in this patient, and this is important not only from the point of view of endoscopists, because we like a healed mucosa, but also, and it is most important, because patients with mucosa indicates have improved long-term outcomes. So at the moment, we can detect and show the mucosa healing, we can also inform our patients of better outcomes. But on the other side, if we want to test the mucosa healing, it seems that the capsule is quite accurate to detect the mucosa healing. This is an interesting paper coming again from Rami Rian in Israel, and they defined they went to follow up patients with active Crohn's disease during after treatment to monitor the response of the treatment and the mucosa healing. And they consider patients in clinical remission or deep remission, that means clinical and biomarker remission. And what they detect is that for if you look at the first on the left, only 15% of patients in clinical remission, they actually have mucosa healing detected by capsular endoscopy. And if you look also at patients with clinical remission and biomarker remission, what they call the deep remission, then only 33% of this group of patients actually they had a mucosa healing. And they went to analyze, to compare also the detection of mucosa healing in these two group of patients, also by comparing capsular endoscopy and MRE. And again, also MRE, only 12% of patients using that were classified as clinical remission they actually had remission, new causal healing at MRI, and again for patients with clinical and biomarkers. And then they want to compare the remission, the clinical remission, deep remission with capsule endoscopy and MRI. And actually, they were able to show that a portion, at least almost 27% of patients that were defined having clinical remission and remission, mucosal healing at the MRI, actually they were actively involved. They had a non-mucosal healing at capsule endoscopy. And this is, they conclude that if we want to prove the mucosal, we want to prove the response of treatment, we want to prove the mucosal healing after treatment, actually the capsule endoscopy is the best option we have at the moment, again, to prove the mucosal healing in patient, even in clinical remission or in the deep remission. So in conclusion, this data suggests that in patients with suspected Crohn's disease, the role of capsule endoscopy is very well defined. We have guidelines. This is not the first line test, but has a role in patients to filter this patient or to exclude Crohn's disease. While in patients with established Crohn's disease, the main indication is the mucosal healing. We should think at the problem of overdiagnosis. And to overcome this problem, it is important, it's essential to properly select our patient. And what is coming from literature is that is the best test that we have at the moment if we want to stage and detect the proximal or mid small bowel involvement. Well, since a group of patients, they might have both the involvement of both small bowel and colon, the ideal situation is to have one test that can be useful and can explore both small bowel and colon. We know by using the capsule endoscopy that at the moment we might use the colon capsule endoscopy, we can manually activate the colon capsule endoscopy to evaluate both small bowel and colon. In the next few months, the registration process is ongoing in Russia. In the next few months, it will be available also in Russia, the new generation, the new concept of capsule endoscopy, that is a pan-entail capsule endoscopy. So we have one single test that can explore the esophagus, the small bowel, and the colon. The technology is very similar to the capsule, to the colon capsule with the adaptive frame rate. We can acquire up to 35 frame rate per second. It starts working with this high number of images since the beginning, so we don't have to activate manually the capsule endoscopy. And also the software is designed for the patients with Crohn's disease. And in fact, we have a new, this is the capsule, and you see that we might have excellent images of the distal small bowel with even very mild signs of inflammation that can be detected, and then the capsule jumps on the right into the colon, and with the proper preparation, we have excellent images. This is the endocytal bulb with some images, and we can have excellent images of both small bowel and colon. This brings back to 20 years ago with the first generation of capsule endoscopy. The name was M2A, and the idea was to have a capsule from mouth to anus. After 20 years, we have actually the capsule that is intended to explore the more gut
более способны вот родовой полости дальнего канала сделать эффективно все снимки, наконец-то
реализовалось.
Does the cost of capsule Ориентируйтесь, пожалуйста, на всех представителей.
Является ли употребление капсулы экономически целесообразным, не слишком ли завышена цена капсульного исследования?
И в Италии процесс был довольно громкий. We have a regional system, so we have different regions that might apply different rules. So in the vast majority of the regions, the capsule rule is now approved, and so it's reimbursed. And for not all the indication, in most of the regions, the approval and reimbursement is for suspect for small bowel bleeding or obscure gastrointestinal bleeding. And for suspected Crohn's disease. At the moment, we are applying also using the literature that is quite strong now to have reimbursement also for established Crohn's disease to monitor the patients during the treatment. This is the situation of Italy. The process was not easy. We had to prove cost-effective trials for both small bowel bleeding and Crohn's disease, but at the end, the national health system included the capsule endoscopy as the essential level of what we call of thirst. So all patients should go to have in specific setting the capsule endoscopy. So at the same time, we were working also with private insurances. There, the process is a little bit more viable because we have different patients who need to convince. But at the moment, after the national system included the capsule as a tool that the national shield system should offer also the private insurances, included the capsule in the list of procedures that they are going to pay. But probably Professor Prochon, they have a huge experience, I think, about reimbursement in France, capsule endoscopy and reimbursement, right? You worked very hard in the past, right?
Could you just take the microphone to you?
Что нам скажет
включите,
пожалуйста,
микрофон. France is an ideal world, at least compared to Italy, because they have very strict and the doctors, you need to prove very much before you get reimbursed, right?
Yes, of course, but in fact, this has been an old process. We got the Rambos maybe 6 or 7 years ago.
У нас были подобные сложности 6-7 лет назад. И мы сейчас предотвратили течение подозрения на болезнь Крона, сейчас нет проблем с капсулой
эндоскопией. I'd say about 12 or 13 when we did it as a group, and we had by the guidelines, so we wrote guidelines.
Society also,
nice on board, and there was nothing to show that this is an issue, and it was automatically taken by the NHS.
And
as part of the project, we also indicated how many tests it would save if you were catching first. Because let's say in the context of obscure GI bleeding, patients would have come in so many times, they have upper GI endoscopy repeated, lots of likely that they understand this is a cost-saving exercise, and that we can discuss that's how they suppose that as soon as that's what they use on the NHS,
move
from other insurance companies to the private side, came on board. And the reimbursement was quite good for the private side, but of course, the years go by, it was very good for the operator.
и плюс диагностическая ценность капсульного исследования очень высока для оперирующих
специалистов.
Большое спасибо
за ваш обзор
по данной проблеме.
Нет
системы использования капсульного
исследования.
Потому что есть страх
с
назначением
политики и
политической целесообразности.
What is your opinion on that?
In Italy we did a study about this that was published in Digestive and Liver Disease a few years ago, just to monitor before and after the reimbursement, and actually there was not the figure was much expected like this, that at the moment we get reimbursement, we increase very much the use of capsular endoscopy. And this didn't happen. What we saw is that
увеличив
количество
Капсульная эндоскопия частично помогла избежать пациентам госпитализации, избежать
сердечных
повреждений.